Today is actually to learn how to build the basic trusted workload or core of the application using the Avalon workshop. So as you can see, it's going to be presented by many people from our community, so each of them will present the part and area of their expertise. So today we're going to have two parts. One starts today, now, and another at 11 o'clock in the same room. And first, we're going to go through the brief Avalon project introduction and architecture. Since the project new, we think that it makes sense. It's not going to be deep dive into design of Avalon, but very brief introduction, just enough to provide context for the rest of the hands-on experience. Then we're going to have a presentation about the cold chain case study, very cool real-world application, so you will know that whatever you learn here, and obviously very exciting for real-world application, that still can be applied to much more serious stuff. And then we're going to have a section on the how to set up the environments using the either Hyperledger Fabric or Hyperledger Vessel. And second half is going to be the three stages of the hands-on experience building the workload. First of all, how to build the general skeleton and make sure that you properly plugged in into framework, how to add your own code, your logic, and then how to have an access to external data in the secure manner from the inside of the trusted execution environment. At the end of each section, we are probably going to have a short section for the QA, but obviously part two is going to be more interactive. This is where we potentially can have more time for the questions. And now let's start talking about what is the Avalon. By the way, please raise your hands who actually knows something about Avalon. Okay. Well, besides presenters, very few people. So the Avalon 3. When we started to work with on applying blockchains to enterprise, what we found that blockchain technology by itself, great. It gives you a lot of capabilities that is very interesting and useful. But at the same time, the whole solution always spreads far beyond the blockchain and includes the legacy application like CRM and others, and access to external data. And how to make, would it then be great if we could extend that computational trust beyond the blockchain itself and go outside world to these additional applications? And that is actually what Avalon is about. We're trying to extend that computational trust going beyond the blockchain to the areas that are not in blockchain. So by itself, Avalon is not part of a blockchain. It actually runs side by side with blockchains. And we focus on the scalability, multi-party trust, privacy, this type of and confidentiality. Avalon implementation is blockchain neutral. In theory, it can run with any blockchain on any DLT with some moderate effort to integrate. Also, a few words about Avalon, where it fits into the Hyperledger ecosystem. This is a new project. We became a top-level project in August of last year. But even though we knew as a top-level project, it's not completely new project. We used to be the Hyperledger Labs project with a different name. And before that, we actually worked on the project called PDO, Private Data Object, which is another Hyperledger Labs project that, so as you can see, we have about a couple years of the efforts under our belt, so this is not completely new technology. We're just making that available through the Hyperledger. An interesting fact about the Hyperledger, we had 16 companies sponsoring the project, which is clearly an indicator of the interest from the industry in this type of solution. So that is how we plan to interact with the different projects within the Hyperledger. So we want to integrate with the as many blockchain as possible. We currently already integrated with Fabric and Vessel, and obviously it gives us very good footprint to integrate with others. We also plan to use the crypto capabilities of the URSA. The solid line shows that what we're going to focus during the workshop today. So a little bit about the kind of few words about how we look at the world. So this is traditional system when couple enterprises want to communicate through the blockchain. They put their data, they put their code on the blockchain, it executes on the every node, and it's available and to the everybody on the blockchain. There are obviously some solutions that are trying to deal with privacy and confidentiality, but fundamentally this is kind of a very high level picture where we start. What we decided to do, instead of the changing the blockchain itself, we decided that one approach is actually to try just to have an additional service that sits on the side of the run side by side with the blockchain. So the enterprise A and enterprise B that want to communicate in this case, they actually agree to communicate and run their smart contracts or other logic if using the trusted compute worker. And the important part that obviously it has been done before, the key here is actually what is this trusted compute worker. So a trusted compute worker is, number one, it can be attested. And that attestation information can be verified by the other parties. So that is actually the number one. The, after the enterprise A and B aware that they can trust to this black box running in the trusted compute service, they actually send their data encrypted to that box. And they know that only inside of that black box, this data can be decrypted and available for execution. And then that box is actually enforces integrity, confidentiality, and enforce other policy of their smart contract. It returns results to them, whoever supposed to see what. It also provides the cryptographic proof to the blockchain that can be later used for auditing or for the dispute resolution. And one more attribute of the system, that enterprises A and B can communicate not only through the blockchain, but then communicate directly with trusted compute service, and they can mix these models the way how they need to optimize the number of transactions and the data privacy and confidentiality the way they need it. And we will see how we do that later. So I will go through now through the couple examples that shows that how we can apply that into the some examples. It's kind of like synthetic examples. We're going to have, as I said, real world, the supply chain example later. So this is IoT with sensors example. So on the left hand side, we have kind of like brutal force approach. We have warehouses. Warehouses have a lot of sensors, temperature, moisture sensors, and they send data in streams. And if we send all this data to blockchain, and we have a lot of warehouses, a lot of sensors, we're pretty quickly going to overwhelm the blockchain, or we can. Even blockchain can handle this stream. It's actually kind of impractical to run the same, a relatively meaningless transaction for every sensor region. So the better approach is actually to aggregate these sensors, process them, and send once a day, for example, the message saying that this warehouse in compliance, or type of how it can, why it's not in compliance. And you can go to this data that's going to be kept off the chain and analyze this data and see the details. And that is actually one of the applications that we believe the Avalon is well suited for, because we can install the trusted compute worker. And in this case, whoever the like enterprise supply chain application can have an, still can trust that the stream is actually was processed by the trusted worker that will enforce the particular policy, and it will maintain the cryptographic proof of what was actually sent through this stream. So that is the our first example how we look at the world. This is where we focus on the scalability through the throttling or the transactions and processing them in batches, and but make it sure that it's fully verifiable and trusted. So another example, this one example is actually focuses more on the confidentiality. So let's imagine there is a small business, well, maybe not a small business, and that small business has a healthy pool of employees. And they want to get the insurance or medical insurance, for example, for their employees. And they want to get a quote from the insurance company. And they want to make sure that as a part of that quote, for example, the heart disease risk assessment would be included in the quote, and they potentially get the lower quote for the insurance. So what they do at the step one, they allow the authorized access to the health records of their employees. During the stage two, they make a request to the insurance company. The insurance company gets the quote request in step three, and step four, which is the most interesting step, where everything is really happens. They start processing the quote. They start processing that in the trusted execution environment. So while doing that in the trusted execution environment, they send the request to another trusted execution environment. And it's possible to establish connections between different trusted execution environments, that each of them runs in the hospital. And that trusted execution environment that runs in the hospital actually makes sure that access to these records for these employees were allowed. It will process these records and provides the intermediate results to the insurance company that finalizes the results and provides the quote to the business. And business obviously will decide if they go with this quote or they want to have another quote. Why two TEs in this case? So the TE is allowed to protect not only data and quote. Insurance company may want to protect the logic, how they analyze the data. So the TE at hospital actually allows to protect that quote. But whenever multiple hospitals return the data, interim data, if there are very few employees at that hospital, technically you can infer some information about those employees through this intermediate data. So the second T at insurance company fully ensures that this cannot happen. It processes the intermediate data again in the black box, and only that black box can access this data. So now, let's look at the architecture, a very high-level architecture of the Avalon. So we can look at that, and really there are three big parts to this architecture. So one of them is the requester application on the left at the bottom. Before I go there, a little bit about the colors. There are blue and orange colors. So blue represents the core logic, the reference implementation of the Hyperledger Avalon that we expect is going to be reused mostly as is. Obviously, some level of customization possible, but it's not really required. While the orange parts represent the code that actually application specific and practically always has to be modified. So the requester application, that is, for example, whatever the software you run on your tracker and the supply chain, the practically always going to be custom built, but we're going to provide a connector library that makes it easier to plug it into the Avalon. There is on the right hand side, there is this big light blue box that actually includes many other boxes. This is trusted compute service, and I return to that in a minute. So, finally, there is the blockchain, and on blockchain, we run some active content depending if this is Ethereum, that would be smart contracts. If this is Fabric, that would be chain code. And requester application has two options to communicate with the trusted compute service. It can communicate through the blockchain, through the smart contracts or chain code, or it can communicate directly using the gRPC through the listener. So now let's go code on the blockchain shown both blue and orange. But it means that we have a code, the reference implementation, that in some cases can be sufficient and can be used as is. In some cases, it may be not sufficient, and then it has to be modified. That is why it has two colors. And the inside of the trusted compute service, we obviously have the corresponding connector to the blockchain and listener for the direct calls. There is a middleware that handles the work orders queue, and that handles the worker registry. And finally, we have the most interesting part is actually the workers themselves. So on the top, we have the worker that is currently uses the term enclave, which actually means that it refers to Intel SGX-based worker. While we assume that it's going to be over the time, we're going to have more workers with different hardware-based TE or the different computer technologies like MPC or zero knowledge proof. That is depicted by the gray boxes on the bottom. So in the trusted compute workers, what we focus on really, we're focusing on the orchestration and separating the key management from the actual work order execution. So the persistent key cannot be seen even by the enclave or more than one, they cannot see at all. So that has actually improved the security and protects from the user errors and application defects. So inside of this worker processing enclave, there is a workload. That is actually the really piece that we're going to focus today. That is the core of the trusted compute application that runs inside of this enclave. It has to be built following the particular logic, and we will go through that. This is bulk of this workshop is actually about this orange box called workload. And during its execution, it can access external data. And during the second part of presentation, we also will show how it can access the internal data to maintain its state, specifically to maintain the counter of the calls. It's obviously going to be a pretty simple example. So now I want to go to the flow, how these components work together at high level. But before that, a few words about the Intel SGX, because that part is going to be slightly Intel SGX specific. So reminder about that blocks. Intel SGX provides that blocks that protects from a whole bunch of different software attacks. It protects including from the attacks from the VMM, from the OS kernel, and practically all software attacks covered here. So the important parts that these enclave or black box can be created at any time. Once it's created and isolated from the application that created it, and it can execute code and protect that from other enclaves, from that application, from OS kernel, from VMM. And it includes, very important, the extendable attestation mechanism. That mechanism, once this attestation report provided to outside world, they can independently verify that this is correct. So this is the high-level flow. I'm not going to go through each arrow here, but the very first step is actually to create enclave, generate its attestation information, and publish this information in the registry, worker registry. Then the requester can go find the right worker for execution, and then verify that this is correct worker and everything fine. It's going to take the encryption key that is available from that store the encryption key and signing key associated, actually verification, part of the signing verification key pair associated with this work order. It's going to use encryption key to submit the, to encrypt its data and submit the request all the way to the trusted compute service. The core logic of the Avalon will deal with all this encryption, decryption, integrity checking. And then it will call the application-specific workload, that is the very right line. And then the results goes back, and when it arrives to the requester to submit it work order request, it can validate that, use the same encryption key to decrypt the data. It also can use the verification key from the enclave to verify that work is actually indeed was done by the intended worker. So that is the high level flow. And I have two more slides that go into a little bit in detail in trust chain and the way how the integrity handled. But I'm not going to through them now. You feel free to go online and look through those details. Instead, I want to have a couple more minutes left at the end of this section for the questions. So please go ahead if you have any questions. Okay, then let me jump through.